today on Christian World News, prisoner of North Korea. Why this Korean-American missionary risked his freedom and his life for the North Korean people.
Plus, in the town where Jesus grew up, archaeologists have made an amazing discovery. A house that might have been standing in the days when he played in the streets of Nazareth.
And no big name actors, no huge production budgets, but this Christian movie is getting a heck of a lot of attention and some awards. A Korean-American risks all for the North Korean people. Hello, everyone. I'm George Thomas.
And I'm Wendy Griffith. North Korea is, of course, one of the most brutal and repressive countries in the world for Christians. But that didn't stop a young American Christian from walking into North Korea on Christmas Eve.
Amazing. 28-year-old Robert Park was on a mission to preach Christianity and to bring attention, as Wendy said, to the country's notorious human rights record. He was arrested, as you can imagine, at the border, and his fate is unknown.
The concentration camps must be liberated.
This is Robert Park in his own words.
You know, I'm a Christian, and in the Bible it says that we must love the lost. We must love the poor and the needy. We must love them more than ourselves.
Days before the crossing, the 28-year-old native of Arizona told the Reuters news agency that he was willing to lay down his life to share the gospel with the North Korean people.
I'm willing to die, actually, from the perspective of liberating North Korea, if I die, it's better. Okay? I mean, personally, you know, it's gruesome and it's hard for me to think about being executed and being beaten, but as a Christian, I have to deny those feelings.
On Christmas Eve, Park entered North Korea by crossing the frozen Tumen River from China. He was carrying with him a lengthy letter for the North Korean leader Kim Jong-il, urging him to accept God's love and to step down from power. Park said he was doing this to raise global attention about the suffering of the North Korean people.
A nation that runs concentration camps, a nation that kills men, women and children without any kind of restraint, can never be trusted.
There are an estimated 200,000 political prisoners languishing in half a dozen or so large concentration camps. Tens of thousands of them are reportedly Christians. 30,000 North Koreans are believed to be practicing Christianity in hiding. According to eyewitnesses, Park was carrying a Bible and shouting, "God loves you and God bless you," as he made the crossing. He was immediately detained by North Korean guards. His excursion into the North and the gospel message he was carrying is sure to upset North Korean authorities.
Proclaiming Christianity is a direct attack on the Kim Jong-il regime, because everyone, of course, in North Korea is raised to worship Kim Jong-il. Kim Jong-il is their god, and Christianity is condemned and can result in being executed.
In Seoul, South Korea, and in his hometown of Tucson, Arizona, family and friends are holding prayer vigils for him. Many of those who have watched his interview online admire him for his courage and passion.
He's a really amazing man of God and compassionate heart, and really loves people and really loves God.
Park can only hope and pray now for some compassion from North Korean authorities. Crossing illegally into the country carries a 3-year prison term. Some activists fear he could be accused of trying to use Christianity to undermine the regime, a crime that carries the death penalty.
For the 8th year in a row, North Korea has been named the world's worst persecutor of Christians. Open Doors International, a ministry to the persecuted church, released its annual World Watch list this week. On CBN's Newswatch, Lee Webb talked with Open Doors USA President Carl Moeller about the countries on that list and missionary Robert Park.
Carl, Robert Park, a North Korean-American Christian, illegally entered North Korea on Christmas Day, as you know, apparently to raise awareness of the suffering there. What do you make of his action, and do you think it's admirable?
Well, you know, sincerely, we don't know Mr. Park, but we do know that the tens of thousands of Christians in North Korea who are suffering desperately do need the world to know of their plight. So in the sense that it brings awareness to the fact that these Christians are suffering mercilessly under the regime of Kim Jong-il in North Korea, it's a good thing. On the other hand, it's more than likely to create an environment of increased pressure and hostility on the Christians, at least in the short term. And while we don't know Mr. Park at all, we're not sure of his connections. So we're hopeful, but that's the best we can say.
I may have misspoken when I said that he's a North Korean. He is actually an American Korean, a Korean American. Carl, though, describe what it's like to be a Christian in North Korea.
Yeah, North Korea is by far the worst place on earth to be a Christian. If you're caught as a Christian in North Korea, for example, having a Bible or leading a Bible study, you can be sentenced to a labor camp, which is very similar to the old Soviet gulag. And not only you, but up to three generations of your family could be put into a labor camp. That would mean yourself, your children, and possibly even your parents thrown into that labor camp. We estimate that maybe 40 to 60,000 Christians are in such a condition today.
Let's look at some of the other nations on this World Watch list that you publish. North Korea is followed by Iran, Saudi Arabia, Somalia, and the Maldives. Rounding out the top 10 are Afghanistan, Yemen, Mauritania, Laos, and Uzbekistan. Yemen has been in the news after the failed Christmas Day bombing over Detroit. Why is that country on the list?
Well, Yemen is a place where Christians are routinely persecuted. In fact, it's against Yemeni law to convert from Islam to any other religion. Particularly, Christianity is singled out for harsh treatment. We know of 35 Christians last year who were incarcerated and most likely tortured for converting from Islam to Christianity. And that's the condition for Christians in Yemen. And of course, we know it's also a hotbed of Islamic extremism, a promoter of radical terrorism.
Eight of the top 10 worst persecutors are Muslim nations. Carl, what can be done to protect Christians in those nations?
Well, first of all, bringing awareness to the fact that in these countries, Christians are singled out for harsh treatment, especially Muslim background believers, those that convert from Islam to Christianity. We can stand with them in prayer. Just being aware of the situation by becoming informed about this Hall of Shame, the World Watch List of those countries that persecute Christians. To pray, to use our voice. There are many ways that Open Doors and other organizations sponsor advocacy programs on behalf of these Christians. And then lastly, of course, there are many ways that clandestinely we're able to support, encourage, and strengthen the Christian communities there through Bibles and training, equipping the church to stand strong in the midst of a storm.
There is a kind of a two-edged sword here, isn't there? Because, I mean, despite this persecution going on in these countries, including North Korea, the church grows through this type of persecution, doesn't it?
That's a great point to make because, you know, although these may be, quote, closed countries in human terms, the Holy Spirit is not prevented from growing the church in these places. And in places like Iran, China, Uzbekistan, we're seeing tremendous revival among Christians in those countries where faith is persecuted, but the Holy Spirit is moving, holy living. And a process of discipleship that is one-to-one is really producing a harvest of great size in these countries. God is moving despite the persecution. And some would even say, as Tertullian, the church father, did, that the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church.
Yes, amen to that. Well, Carl Muller of Open Doors USA, we appreciate what your ministry does in bringing this to light, and we know that many will be praying for you and your ministry as well as those who are being persecuted for the gospel.
Thank you, Lee.
And to see the entire World Watch list and learn how you can help the persecuted church, just visit our website, cwnews.org.
Egyptian authorities have arrested three men in the Christmas Eve attack on a church that left six churchgoers and a Muslim guard dead. This video taken from YouTube shows injured worshippers outside the church. Police say all three suspects have criminal records. Meantime, order has been restored after thousands of Christians rioted following the attack. Christians, mainly Coptic, account for 10% of Egypt's mainly Muslim population. An Amnesty International report says sectarian attacks on Christians increased in 2008.
In Malaysia, Muslims firebombed four churches amid a growing conflict over the use of the word Allah. this was the only church to be seriously damaged. Last week, a Malaysian court struck down a ban forbidding Christians to use Allah when referring to God. The court ruling is sparking Muslim protests throughout the country. One speaker said, quote, "We will not allow the word Allah to be inscribed in your churches." Another said, "Islam is above all. We can fight to the death over this issue.
Up next.
God does not just have a purpose for your days, but a purpose for your life.
An epic adventure film about faith, and it's made by homeschoolers.
CWNews.org, your constant news source on the World Wide Web. Find daily updates on the global church. Watch the weekly broadcast.
Three former presidents come together to honor the life and ministry.
Also available in podcast, the in-depth insights into our reporter blogs.
Taliban kidnapped at least 18 South Korean Christians.
Your online news source for complete coverage of the global church.
Thanks, Pete. Hi, I'm Terry Musin. We receive so many letters and emails from viewers who say their day just isn't the same if they don't see the 700 Club. That's why I'm so excited to tell you that you'll never have to miss another show. The 700 Club's here for you every Monday through Friday with stories of hope and encouragement, practical information to make your life better, and insight you need to make sense of what's going on in the world. It's never been easier to see the 700 Club. Even if breaking news interrupts us, you can still watch the show. Call this number or go to CBN.com to get this list of all the different channels in your area where you can see the 700 Club. With the 700 Club airing on so many channels, you can choose the one that's best for you. So remember, no matter what happens, whether it's big or small, you can always see the 700 Club.
Call or log on to CBN.com for this important information.
Daddy?
Yeah, buddy?
How many nickels are in a dollar?
There are 20 nickels in a dollar.
How do birds fly? Does milk really make my bones stronger?
Yeah.
Daddy, when we die, will we go to heaven?
Do you have the answer to life's biggest question? Call the 700 Club. We'll help you find answers to the important questions life brings your way.
Well, George, there's a new movie out, a Christian movie on DVD, and it's called Pendragon. Two homeschool families produced the movie in their own backyard.
And despite these humble origins you talk about, the movie has won numerous awards. It portrays one man's struggle to follow God's call in the face of adversity. Evan Graham has the details.
Remember, son, God does not just have a purpose for your days, but a purpose for your life.
The Pendragon is an epic adventure set in the dark ages of Britain. It tells the story of a young warrior named Artos who sets out to defend his people, but he finds himself in unbelievably difficult circumstances, and he must choose between following God's call and walking away. And for Artos, following that call would cost him everything.
When I set out on this journey, I expected the Saxons to stab me in the back, but not my friends.
And as he struggled with the loss of his family, with the destruction of everything he loved, with even betrayal by his friends, by his commander, and still he finds his hope and he finds his purpose in God.
Our hope is that viewers will see this movie and they'll be encouraged and inspired to follow the Lord's call in their life. And I think the Lord calls each one of us to do something. It talks about in Ephesians that there are good works that he has laid out beforehand for us to walk in.
The Pendragon was produced by the Burns Family Studio, which is made up of two sets of parents and their 9 children.
From the beginning, both of our families had a desire to see our children love and serve the Lord and love and serve one another. And the Pendragon Project gave us such a wonderful opportunity to do that together.
I mean, I never dreamed that we would be filming a movie of this scale in our backyard. How many parents have the opportunity to work with their college age children on a project working for the Lord of this magnitude?
The Pendragon is a family-friendly film which honors the Lord, and it features everything from sword fights to a damsel in distress to a hero who rides in to save the day. Ephraim Graham, CBN News.
Great stuff. Well, you can find the movie at Christian bookstores, or you can go and order it online. Just go to our website, cwnews.org, for a link to the Pendragon website.
Well, thousands of college students from around the world converged in Atlanta, Georgia this week at the Passion Conference 2010. More than 20,000 students from 37 countries packed the Georgia World Congress Center in downtown Atlanta. The conference challenged students to worship the Lord with their lives and to impact the lives of others who are hurting all over this world. Students answered that call by raising $1.3 million in global aid. Some of the ministries helped by the Passion Outreach include World Vision, Hope International, and Compassion International.
Well, North America's next generation of missionaries met in St. Louis, Missouri this month. They're part of InterVarsity's 22nd Missions Conference called Urbana, and our very own Heather Sells was there.
More than 16,000 students descended on St. Louis from across the U.S. and Canada. Their purpose, to learn more about missions and God's calling on their lives.
Well, I think at Urbana what you find is a large number of students who are serious about their faith. They're serious about how their faith intersects the global needs.
Today's young people are thinking about missions in new and fresh ways. They're concerned about social justice issues as well as evangelism. And they're thinking about how to reach emerging communities such as Muslims and gays.
You know, one of the things that we found is that college students are the most hungry group of people to really learn what it means to build bridges with the gay and lesbian community, because it is getting thrown in their faces 5 days out of the week, 8 hours a day on the campuses.
More than 1,000 young people packed Marin's seminar on reaching out to gays. His focus, helping students find ways to dialogue with gay friends instead of cutting them off. Thousands more are choosing seminars on social justice issues like poverty and AIDS. For many, it's a unique opportunity to learn more about global needs and where they might fit in.
There's a lot of need, especially with like refugees.
I just wanted to get some focus on what the next step was and also get to hear from other people that have kind of gone before me.
InterVarsity leaders say they'll challenge students to commit. For some, it may actually be a first-time decision for Christ, but for many others, it will be a commitment to missions and wherever that takes them.
We're going to see a generation of students called into modern-day missions. At this convention, from the platform, the seminars, the exhibit hall, you're going to see students make the decision that will lead them throughout the course of their lives to a lifelong commitment to missions.
Reporting in St. Louis, Heather Sells, CBN News.
It's the one thing news viewers can agree on.
They want change.
Now, the world's leading Christian news organization brings you national, international news and analysis throughout the day. Mornings, the busy lunch hour, late afternoon, and evenings. It's news with a Christian perspective whenever you want it. Available on the web 24/7 at cbnnews.com. There you were, on your way to financial security.
Continue straight ahead to reach your financial goals.
When suddenly, everything changed. Your road to financial freedom, gone. Traditional ways of investing no longer work. You need direction.
Recalculating. Turn here.
Discover a biblically based way to navigate your financial future. Pat Robertson's teaching, Right on the Money, shows you what works and what doesn't. Establish a budget. Get out of debt. Build your savings. Learn how to invest. Get Pat Robertson's Right on the Money when you join the 700 Club and get on the road to a more secure future. Available now.
As co-host of the 700 Club, I see incredible stories of God's faithfulness to our viewers every day. It builds our faith to see what God is doing in people's lives. Perhaps you've seen a miracle in your finances. We'd like to share your story with others so that they too can be encouraged. Please call 1-800-759-0700 or log on to CBN.com. We want to hear from you. Your life can inspire others.
Obsession, it's not a word you usually think of in a positive way, but author and speaker Anne Graham Lott says her obsession is the passionate pursuit of a God-filled life, and she's written about it in her new book, The Magnificent Obsession, Embracing the God-Filled Life, and she joins us now from our D.C. studios to talk about it. And you set out to know God better by examining the life of Abraham. Why Abraham?
You know, I was teaching the Bible for the first time 33 years ago and began in the book of Genesis, came to his biography in chapter 12, and it's like he walked off the pages of my Bible into my life. And the thing that struck me when I finished the study of his life was that he was a very ordinary man who actually became extraordinary, because when God said, Abraham, I want you to follow me in a life of obedient faith, Abraham did. One step at a time, one choice at a time, day after day, for all of his life, and at the end of his life, God said that Abraham was his friend. And three times in Scripture, God says, Abraham is my friend. And I thought, you know, it'd be one thing if I called God my friend, but if God leaned out of heaven and said, Ann Lotz is my friend, that's impressive.
And Ann, but how can we know God the way Abraham did?
Well, Abraham knew God through listening to his voice, being obedient to what God said, trusting him with hard things. When he failed, he went back to God, got right with him. He built his altars, which would be the equivalent of praying, and coming to God through sacrifice. And so for us, it's the same thing. And we establish our personal relationship with God when we come to the cross. And we confess our sin, tell God we're sorry, ask him to forgive us, to come into our lives, claiming Jesus as our Savior. And we establish our relationship. We're born again at that point and become a child of God. But then that's just the beginning. And I think a lot of Christians stop there. And actually, that's the beginning, because then you begin to develop this personal relationship with God, very much like with a spouse, where you spend time with that person. You talk to them and listen to what they have to say. And God talks to me as I read my Bible. I listen for his voice to speak to me. I talk to him when I pray. And then I take my Bible, apply it to my life, live it out. And so I obey and follow him one step at a time. And it doesn't mean I always know exactly what to do or that I don't make mistakes, but it's a journey of faith.
Well, and we can't let you go without asking about your dad, Billy Graham. How's he doing?
You know, he's doing well. I think he celebrated his 91st birthday. We had Thanksgiving week together, and it reminds me a lot of Abraham, just in his age and the depth of his relationship with God. And right now, of course, without my mother, it's his relationship with God that carries him through the day with hope and joy and peace in his heart. And it's a relationship that I believe that Abraham had. It's one that I want to have too, Wendy, because people can come and go, and our finances can come and go, and our children can come and go, and our health can come and go, but it's our relationship with God that transcends everything, that's permanent, actually. It's not even interrupted by death.
Anne Graham Lotz, thanks so much for being with us.
Thanks, Wendy.
We'll be right back.
I have the privilege of traveling all over the world and seeing firsthand the life-changing things you make possible through your partnership. Thank you for joining the 700 Club. Here in India, you're demonstrating the love of God to such wonderful people, most of whom are in great need, both physically and spiritually. You're bringing hope and joy to millions around the world. Just like you did for Chen Yu, born with a serious heart defect, doctors said he would soon die. His parents couldn't afford surgery. That's when you provided the operation that saved his life. Your monthly gift makes it possible to heal the sick, feed the hungry, and preach the gospel, both at home in America and throughout the world. So please watch for this mailing and send in your pledge. Imagine lifting someone's life out of despair and filling it with hope instead. That's what you make possible every day. And it only happens because you were there.
There you were, on your way to financial security, when suddenly everything changed. Your road to financial freedom, gone. You need direction. Discover a biblically based way to navigate your financial future.
Pat Robertson's teaching, Right on the Money, shows you what works and what doesn't. Available now.
Christian World News, your window to the global church. For stories of revival.
Another revival.
Persecution.
Relatives and fellow Christians born in
first country over the international dateline.
I'm George Thomas in Baghdad, and coming up on the broadcast, an exclusive interview.
And the impact of Christian leaders. Watch Christian World News.
Well, for the first time, Israeli archaeologists have uncovered a house from the time of Jesus in the town where he grew up.
Pretty exciting stuff. CBN's Julie Stahl has that story from Nazareth.
Most people only know about the life of Jesus from what they read in the Bible. Archaeologist Yardena Alexander says the discovery of this small house sheds much more light on how people live their everyday lives in the Galilee town of Nazareth.
What we can learn is a little bit about the lifestyle. I would say that certainly the remains that we have are very simple, and it reflects simple houses that must have existed in the small village of Nazareth.
The house consisted of interconnected rooms, a courtyard, and a water cistern. There appear to be no luxuries or imported goods. Remains of pottery and vessels found at the site also confirmed the Jewish character of the city.
There were probably about 50 homes in Nazareth at the time of Jesus. Some experts say because the village was so small that Jesus and boys his age likely knew the home and played in it.
Located at the heart of ancient Nazareth, the remains of the house are just across the street from another landmark, the Basilica of the Annunciation. Catholic tradition says this was the site where Mary lived when she was visited by the angel Gabriel, telling her she would bear a child, the Messiah. Also at the site is a pit that Alexander believes was dug out of rock as a hiding place.
I think that it was excavated by the people who were living in this house for the purpose of hiding from the Roman army at the time of the Great Revolt. We're talking now about 67 CE. This is the great Jewish revolt against the Romans.
All of this was discovered because of plans for a new Catholic center. Throughout Israel, archaeologists go to a site before construction to look for history.
But these salvage excavations carried out by the Israel Antiquities Authorities are terribly important because you don't know what to expect, and very often you come up with very important finds which can tell us about life in the ancient days.
Center developer Mark Hodara wants to preserve the remains.
I think it's a gift for Christmas, because we are for Christmas. It's a gift for the center also, because many people would like to see the place.
Today, Nazareth is a bustling city of some 75,000 residents. Once a predominantly Christian city, it is now more than half Muslim. But even after 2,000 years, the city's fame still comes from the Jewish carpenter who grew up there. Julie Stahl, CBN News, Nazareth.
Have you ever been to Nazareth?
No, I haven't.
I went,
Bethlehem, but not.
I went there once, and there's nothing like walking where Jesus walked.
Wow.
You've got to experience that to know what, you know, I'm talking about.
Amazing experience. Well, that's it for our show this week.
From all of us here at CWN, God bless you.